before I introduce our guest, I'd like to give you a brief introduction of the project, which is rather unknown for us. Euralel is a project in connection with a station on the Tisjevø line, London, Marseille. In the primary plans, there was no intention at all of stopping training within the city of Lille. The Lord Mayor did see how this could part the city for ever and started working on letting the train into the city. He did so by developing an area just outside the medieval walls, and he commissioned the Dutch architect Wim Koolhaas from the Office of Metropolitan Architect, Rotterdam. The work was very successful. The site is under construction, being connected to the Tisjevø line, and the architects have created a fascinating home plan, very Oma-like, and has gained a European prize, the Gaudi Prize, in 1991. That was nice. I have the pleasure to introduce Mr. Paul Danzig from Oma and Rotterdam. He is completely unknown to us, but then again, the more there is to learn. Danzig is educated in Delft, 76, and started working with Wim Koolhaas in 87. He was in the beginning running the art department, dealing with Oma's publications and exhibitions and so forth. In 89, he was involved with the development of the Euralel project and was put in charge of the project team. Since 89, he has condemned 3 cars traveling from Rotterdam through Belgium to Lille, France, and he has 2 more years to go. We are very happy that this Flying Dutchman could put this trip into his very tight schedule, and I know I have all project leaders with me, then I welcome Mr. Danzig and wish him a calm, nice and relaxing visit to Norway. Please, Mr. Danzig.
I didn't know I told you so much about myself.
You did.
Can I ask you, because I'm giving my lecture with slides, so I'd like you to make it all dark. I don't know how dark you can make it for your camera.
Completely.
That's nice. Okay. I will explain what there are a certain amount of components that or elements that were very important for the success of the project, and the first one is the fact that Lille is a city that I discovered only when we started doing the project. It was more like some traffic jam on the way to Paris, and that's all I knew about it before. And then I discovered that it's really an important metropolitan region of 1 million people, which is the third French metropolitan region. But the people have this characteristic of being very much on their own, so living within the sort of boundaries of this region and viewing, seeing themselves as being in the first place belonging to this region of the north of France. And they have also a kind of naivete and a sort of strong liking for the traditions and the culture they're having. And what this project is doing is connecting the city to the 21st century. So what it had to do is not only to create a project but also to create a mutation or a transformation in the appreciation of their own metropolis of the people in this region. And so the first and important element is a quantum leap in terms that the project is becoming a part of the city, but at the same time it is a completely new part, and it makes a new interpretation of the city possible because it will connect the city to a regional network. the high-speed trains are in a way complementary to the air network, which is more or less saturated there. Sometimes in airfields like Paris, you can have for the local flights enormous waiting times sometimes because it's really saturated. So these trains, they have the same capacity in terms of time of connecting on large distances up to 700 kilometers in the same time span. And what is interesting about it is that the price is the price of a normal train ticket. So all of a sudden, this travel, which has the speed, and you can transit over distances that are normally only be covered by airplanes, and it's now accessible for in a way anyone. It's popular and accessible. And what you already can see is that English people are buying land in Normandy and places close to this line, with the idea that when you're living somewhere in the countryside of Kent, or when you're living in Normandy, not too far from this high-speed train line, you're in time-wise as far from the center of London. It's the same distance. So why not buy a house where there is still a lot of land available? So people are already starting to view space and the territory in a very different way. You're not trying, but it is. Okay, so this is to give you a sense of the scale. This is the region between to the east, Frankfurt to the Ruhr, London to the west, to the north, Rotterdam and Paris to the south. And this is to give you an impression of a sort of very normal scene of the town. So the town has what they call, it's very Flemish. And maybe this has played a role in all naivete of the choice of a Dutch architect, thinking that he would do something like this for their new city. But of course, it turned out something very different. And so the debates in the beginning were also very fierce with local politicians and responsible people. And this thing, I don't know how many can read French. It has to do with the elections that are currently happening in France. And it says, goodbye, left. French will live again, or come by again. And I showed it to explain that, of course, to do a project of this scale, it takes about 6 years. You need also a political leadership of the city and of course, a strong direction of the project to get it through in a certain time span. And it's dealt with in two ways. On the one hand, the mayor of the central city of the region has not only secured through an election his position as a mayor, at least up to 95, but he became also president of the regional council, which is a council which takes account of about 100 smaller cities around the central city. So he secured in a way his own position. That was very important in convincing mayors of other cities of slowing down the process of extension and growth in their cities, to let grow this one center, which would be a sort of gravity, center of gravity connecting the metropolis to the TGV system. Otherwise, the station would be just a hub or a stopover. And the direction of the whole project is in the hands of a public-private partnership, which is I don't know whether you know this in Norway, but normally that is a sort of thing that is directed by politicians. It's half at least state-owned, but this one is directed by people which come from private companies, and they run it like a private company. It has also the aim to make profit, which is of course very strange for something that is half state-owned. And the city, who is really no money at all, they made their money because of the realization of the project. They owned the land, which was very fortunate. They owned 60 hectares of land between the central city and its periphery. So really the most, sort of present in a way from the military history of the city that they got. And by voting the project, they simply they won millions and millions of francs, which allowed them to be a real partner for the banks and have 50% of the shares. This shows the system and the main airfields. London is not London Heathrow, Paris Roissy, and up to the French sea, La Haye, The Hague as the main city, because they don't understand that Holland has an administrative capital and an ideological capital, and two cities, but anyway. And then Brussels and the Ruhr. So the yellow ones are the trains we're discussing with. And this gives you an idea of the time. So the furthest away from Lille, for instance, is Marseille. It's 5 hours, and it's over 1,000 kilometers. So all of a sudden, there is an enormous contraction of the territory by the simple speed of the trains. You get to Paris in 1 hour, which is not so much more than a commuter would take to get to Paris from any of the Parisian new towns. Or you get in 25 minutes to Brussels, which is really nothing. I mean, 25 minutes, if you, for instance, consider it within the city of Paris, it would take you only to through half of the central city, time-wise. Another important thing is that the project would be realized. This is the black thing is the military fortification, within which the central city always has been maintained, and the main fortification of the French military engineer of Louis XIV, Vauban, this thing. And the project will be done on the east flank of these fortifications, which has been a void up till today. And as being a void, it is also the node of all kinds of transportation systems. So the reds are the trains, and the blues are the metro lines. And it's also a hub for the local public transport. And there are national motorways just passing by here. So you have a fortunate situation of a vacant piece of land, which is almost in the middle of the city, and which is connected by virtue of all means of transportation. So this is the site. The site is almost 3 kilometers. What we're dealing with, it goes a bit farther on. It's an abandoned railroad yard. It is to be abandoned fairgrounds. These are just parkings, wild parkings. And the red thing is the TGV line. So it crosses really a sort of void between the periphery and the city. And what we're doing is we're doing the first part of the project, which is here and here. And these things are meant to be done later on. So here you see again the traffic system, the trains in yellow, the metros in blue, and the cars in red. And here you see what happens below. So at the same time, it's an enormous opportunity, but because it was such a vacant lot of land, any of the city services plumbed it full with their own kind of underground infrastructure, from sewers to telecommunication lines to whatever. The next thing we got is the program, where it was explained that there were three important elements. One is a center, basically commercial. One is a business center, which should be related to the train station. One is the center of fairgrounds, which had to be renovated. And we were proposed with the possibilities of displacing the motorway, which is running here, over superposing it on the railroad tracks, and thereby liberating a lot of land. And it had to be connected to a 60s office center. And this gray part is to say that the main hyper center of the city. And here starts already the periphery. So we were really able to, for once, bridge the city to the periphery, which always had been disconnected. This is to give you an idea of the idea of the scale of the program. If we would do the program in one slab, it would be a 2.5 kilometer slab of 10 stories high, where you have here the relative importance of the different components. Or if you compare it in scale to other French projects, this is a... But you could also take it, I mean, it's from here to there. It is 40 city blocks of Manhattan. Or it is as big as the central part of La Défense, which is the office area to the east of Paris. But in terms of density, it's still rather modest. It's about 1/3 of the density of this project. But if you compare it, to the normal production of the whole region, it is enormous. The first phase, which is done in 95, will be about about 8 times the year production to be realized in 3 years. So it needed a really a cohesion and stopping off project in other areas to be able to do this amount of building. But this is a scheme of the project that we first did, which is the first scheme we did was to do a project on the whole site, and then to concentrate in this area, which has the park, the central business district, the retail center, and the fairground. And to the fair was later connected a program for a rock auditorium and the Congress Hall. This is a next analysis of the infrastructures. The gray are the military infrastructures, which were at the root, of course, of the fact that the land was still vacant in our time. So that's the 18th century. And the railroad engineers plunged in their tracks at their convenience, in a way, into the city in the 19th century. Then the road engineers brought in the through autoroutes. It's a 6-lane autoroute. And then the 21st century would change this again by bringing in the high-speed train. It shows also that it is really it's open and it's completely filled up with infrastructure. So one of the first things we started proposing is to change the trajectory of this road and make it parallel to the train station in order to open up really the land between the city and the new project. So here you have the station and the proposed trajectory for the motorway, and in between a parking, which allowed that you could go off from the motorway, go straight into the parking and take the train, or go into the parking and go to the offices or other buildings on top of it. So that meant that the people that came from the motorway or come from the motorway don't appear on the urban streets, which of course has an enormous effect on the density of traffic on the surface. Here you see the thing in the construction about 2 years ago, where the first thing was to start building the station and to make a first deviation of the motorway. So it was like this, it now is like this, and it will be straight down. This is again so the area of the motorway, the parkings, the station, and the commercial center in this area, which is the size of the commercial center, to give you a dimension, is 50,000 square meters. The length of the station is 500 meters, and this area is a 10 hectare, so 100,000 square meter park, which is partially built over the station. The project also depended on a number of inventions, and one of the inventions was doing a perimeter wall around the project. The perimeter wall is economically interesting because it means that all the foundation of these buildings, they are below the water tables. And thanks to this perimeter wall, there was very little pumping to be done. And all buildings could be done within the same protected area. So every building had to do its own protection. And it is on some places like here, it's used also for the foundation of the building. So it has a that's the second use it has. And the third is that we propose to break open the station in order that from the trains you can see the city and you don't just pass by, but also from the city you see the trains, which is in a way the whole starting point of the project. And that meant that we had to create a public plaza which is below the water tables. And the only way to do, of course, a public space below the water tables is having some device of keeping it out. So that's the third and, I think, most important function of this perimeter wall. So here you see the situation in a more recent version. Here you see the perimeter wall running, which will be used by the parking between the station over here and the motorway as a part of their foundations. So this to show you what the station started off when the engineers, they were not really imagining any station at all. They just had to pass their train. And as Birger Heyerdahl said, it was foreseen to just connect it to the airfield. And the mayor really had to fight to get the thing to his city. And the response to this from the French railroad was that the mayor had to pay several hundred millions of francs to get it there. So the mayor was, once he signed up the contract, forced to create a project to win back the money to pay the railroads. But the guys, they didn't imagine a station at all. So what I thought was it would be just the through station, or the through lines, and then in the middle, and then the platforms to the side, and then maybe somewhere some sort of a building. But what we wanted is to open it up to one side to the public space, and to the other side to open it up to the parking, so that you could have this direct connection between different modes of transportation. And from there on, and of course also to bring daylight within the building. So as it is built now, you have skylighting, but also this is the platform on the parking side. And you still can look through it to the public plaza on the other side. So you have a full transparency to the station, and there's a constant presence of daylight, which of course you don't have in a tunnel. So when we started criticizing the engineers on this thing, they moved in an architect who started understanding a little of this station and the opportunities it has in the project, that there would be also a road running over it. So if you would just bluntly run the road over this thing, then passengers that were on this platform, they had to cross a road or to go somewhere else. So they invented a mezzanine, but we thought that the mezzanine, you still have a tunnel in a way, even if you make some holes. And then they did the next step, which I think was the real necessary thing, is to say, okay, we have the level of the platforms, we have the mezzanine that runs under the viaduct that crosses the station here. And then we have a next step, which is an entrance level, which is connected to the roads that are running over the parkings on this side. And then and from there on, the station became like a stepping stone in these three steps, the connector between the street of the business center and the public plaza on the other side. So here you see it in a section, the motorway, which eventually will be covered so that the space of the motorway will be won back as public pedestrian space. The area where you have the parkings, and under the parkings runs a metro train. The station, where the towers on top of the station are sinking with their feet really into the train station. And then to the city side, the viaduct, and south of the viaduct, the commercial center, and north, a park. So you have all of a sudden all these conditions. So even a park, which is in sort of symbol of social public space in the heart of the city. This is one of the models we did from the station before assembling it. The track level, the mezzanine level, where you have the waiting halls, the ticket sales, shops, whatever. And then the top level, which carries the road and which carries platforms through which you can get into the station. And you can sink from stairs from this level into the station and then from another passage onto the plaza. So there is a full transparency for any pedestrian movement through it. So the building itself participates in the public realm. So this to explain the basic components of the project. The retail center, the public space, the park, the seven towers over the northern three are over the station, and the other ones are over the tunnel. So the ones that are over the station are expressed by being larger and having their really bridging the station, so having the structure on the sidewalk. Whereas these ones, they inscribe themselves in the width of the station. So you get in this street, which is about 1 kilometer, you get four conditions. One is that you start driving along a park, then you have these three buildings that have their foundations in the street, then you have a series of buildings that have a more modest size, and then become more large-scale projects, and eventually a large-scale project to the other side, which is the Congress and Exhibition building that OMA is doing. because that was part of our commission, is that we would do the architecture of the global plan. We would do one building, and we would at least propose the names of the architects for each of the operations. Because what we thought is that by naming the architects of all the operations, we could think of people that could imagine a response or make a proposal that would coexist within the plan. We were not intending to guide all these architects, but we were looking for people that would understand the plan and would understand that they could, in a way in which they could give a response which allowed coexistence of all these elements. So it's built from a socle, which is parkings, which is the track level, and which is parkings again. So the business center, the commercial center, and the congress center, they all have their, because the site that is taken by the buildings leaves nothing over for parking, so the parking is obligatory under the buildings. And in terms of, say, the whole organization of the project is also interesting, because the firm that is doing the land development of the whole area is also the entrepreneur who's the developer of all the parkings. So they have already a risk, but also a say in what's happening in the buildings over, which you can imagine is very important, as there are some 10 developers concerned with this building, and here each and every tower is also again and again another developer. So the way to make these developers work together was that the land developer also develops the whole basement of the project. And it is, of course, a very profitable operation as well. So here you have the level above, because the city is say, and this commercial center is on say, at grade, and the business center is at plus one. You have in the business center parkings that go just one level over where this part. But that allows here to connect road, parking, mezzanine of the station, and through the mezzanine of the station, the retail center, and then into the city. And so this is the main public level where you find the commercial, the Congress building, and so on and forth. So here you find the things on a model in the one of the more recent versions. So to make a section in the length along the station, this is the park, the station with the three bigger towers, and then in the end over the tunnel we continue the socle, which is here a station, into a socle which has services, shops, restaurants, and the towers on top of it. So the towers, they bring life to the socle, and the socle itself creates on the level of the pedestrian a sort of civic life which is quite close to conventional civic life where you have an urban street, and the urban street is on both sides dotted with all kinds of programs like restaurants, shops, whatever. So it's at the same time it is a very contemporary architecture, and it allows the inscription of almost conventional civic life. Here the stepping of the station, and the form it gets finally through the architecture of the French railroads architect. So there you see a sort of collision as well. We were very happy that this architect understood the project and helped us to work out a scheme that was a good reply to the urban context we were proposing. At the same time, he is doing a sort of roof which I think is a sort of hybrid between the 19th century and the 19th century forms and 20th century engineering. So here you see the basic node where the road crosses the station, and where you really have all the connections between the public space, the station, the mezzanines, up into the tower where the taxis make their drop-offs, and so on and forth. So this is a sort of connector of the whole process. This is a section the other way around. I start in the east, the motorway, the zone where the parkings are, and the metro station, the metro lines, the train station, the towers over the train station, which have their foundations on either side. Then the lake in front of the station, which also gives a funny effect because the trains, they are a little bit lower than the water. So the trains, they you can only see the window, so you see the trains like a boat gliding into the station. And then the section continues through the commercial center, where you have a row of restaurants, and then stepping up to the main retail level, which is the level also of the existing city. And above that, a second retail level, which is connected over the existing railroad tracks on the city side to a deck of the existing business center in the city. The main, say the answer we found to into bringing a building which is so big into the fabric of the city, which is relatively delicate and of another scale. The building is 50,000 square meters, and so it's doing about 10 city blocks or something like that. One thing was to make it measurable, that the building, the size of the building, so to bring to think about the slope of the roof, which allows from the public space to see the surface of the roof, which meant that you could see the surface of the roof as a plane and see where the beginning building begins and where it ends. And of course it helped also to cover up all the technical amenities that normally pop up in these roofs of commercial centers. So here you see what it does in a section, looking for a slope so that you can see over the roof, see higher buildings in the city, and at the same time create on the edge of the building a new urban horizon of a set of towers that are sitting there. Then the connection to city blocks, I mean the normal city blocks are this kind of things, or this thing. So we're looking for ways into bringing the business, the shopping center in the same kind of scale, so that its malls would participate as streets in the urban system. And this is what came out of it. So you have the yellow is the restaurants, which are developed on two levels, stepping down to the lower plaza, and then here the main retail center, and here the hypermarket, which is I think a very French thing. This one is two level, and it's about 20,000 square meters of shopping where you have these caddies moving around. And there are two main malls. One is this one. It's the main public space within the building connected to the plaza. And then there is a diagonal which starts under the high hovering, it's 20 meters above the street level hovering roof. And it's orientated to the most southern tower over the station. This is when the image that is created by the commercial people. And they were, so in a way, warning us what they were thinking that should be done. So it's in a way, it's frightening, but it's also interesting to know how these people believe they can sell off their restaurants. So it helped us also to be able to discuss with them and to feel about their sensitivities and how they approach their future clients. So here you have the ensemble of the building. And it's carrying a lot of components. This is the whole building. But here, for instance, is a World Trade Center. This is housing. Within the housing block, there is a hotel. The hotel has a breakfast room, which is under this high hovering roof. And these towers are residential. One is a hotel. Another one is a sort of semi-hotel for people living there one or two months. And one is for students. And these two are offices. In this level there are schools. There is economical school. Here in this part is a theater, and here will be all kinds of leisure facilities. And running over the existing tracks will be a passerelle that pops into the building at this point. This is just to show another complexity of the project. Each and every color means a different owner. So you can imagine the complexity of building a building that is owned by so many people and so therefore so many responsibilities. and where you even from time to time discover, like here, white spots that were forgotten to be sold. This is a view of very recently from the over the station. Here you see the roof of the station under construction. This is the bridge construction, the scaffolding for the middle tower. And here you see the shopping center. This is the main shopping area. And here is the lower parking area, and the middle floor is not yet built. It's starting off here some. And this is the existing station and the other business center. So it will connect this business center over here through this building and then to the plaza. So here you see how we engaged in opening up the station. The public space will have a slope which is more or less like this, but of course much more controlled. And so it creates a sort of a theater towards the station. This is a part of the middle tower in the bridge construction. And you can see the tremendous trouble of building it. This yellow thing is a scaffolding for this thing, but the scaffolding it crosses straight through this roof. So there are hollow elements where one column is going through the other column to be able to make this sort of temporary crossing of structures. And in between, so in the public plaza, what we intend to do in between, which is in this surface, is to make a wooden plaza which runs parallel to the station and which runs under the viaduct, so that the two parts of the plaza that are cut off or that are crossed over by the viaduct have also their continuity in the fact that the wood runs through and that next to the wood there is the canal running along the station. So you have this set of linear elements, the station, the canal, and the wood part, and then from here comes in the park. Over here the restaurants and the terraces. When we had to deal with all the architects, on the one hand, what we did is making a project with very abstract buildings, just parallelograms and saying, okay, this is the kind of volumes we're thinking of and describing how they would function, and also having analyzed how it works structurally or how it works commercially or how to. So it was well researched on the one hand. We were working with developers who had only the mission in, say, teaching us how French developers work. And then for each building, a different architect would be asked. And the first time it was presented here, you have the whole packet of architects. There's Rem Koolhaas, Christian Poisson-Parr, Claude Vasconi, Jean Nouvel, and Kazuo Shinohara. So it started off like this, just simple parallelograms. And on the one hand, we invited the architects to subscribe the volume, so stick to the building height. So, for instance, the building rules described a minimum building height for this area. And on the other hand, each one found his own expression for the building. This is the most northern tower by Shinohara. This is his first project. You have to the restaurant and the banquet halls and all these things, the communal services in this slab, sticking over the lake and the public plaza. A swimming pool, and then the rooms on top of it. I think a very interesting Japanese proposal for a European city. And then the developers started thinking that it should be bigger, so they asked for something more. And then Shinohara thought, well, if you want this, then I kick out my swimming pool. So there happened two things. On the one hand, the developers were demolishing the project, and on the other hand, you can see with these drawings, it was the most popular project of the whole scheme. And then it was invented that it could only be done if there were offices, so the hotel became this, and these were offices. And then it was found out that you couldn't make offices and a hotel in one building. So then it became this, and Shinohara withdrew, of course. And we only, we're not very happy, but we're still working on it to modify this. But that's the hardship. I mean, you can imagine a project, but you don't have a full control. So you have to work by conviction. You cannot imply solutions. Another tower was done by Richard Rogers, who really well understood the functioning, the bridging, the station, and expressed the bridging with, what is it, Fitzpatrick from Over Arabs, by making, four bridges, one on top of the other, with gardens in between. But we thought it was at the same time interesting and programmatically interesting, but at the same time dated. And the developer didn't know what to do with it, so he left, abandoned the project. Then we started working with another developer who had very different demands. At the same time, there was more research about the fact that we were not only bridging station, but also bridging a metro line which goes here diagonally. And they found out that the foundations of this metro line were much more complicated than were told before. So we had to analyze the program, which wasn't big enough to do the full tower, so which had to leave out elements. We had to analyze the structure and also to think of someone who could do it. And it also allowed us to bring back another idea, is that the middle tower should be more fat than the other towers. And we asked Christian Poisson Park to do it, of whom we thought that he could really control a program that difficult and a form that difficult. And he made an answer where the floor plan is wedge-shaped, so it becomes from the public plaza is on this side, it becomes more wide to this side, and then it grows more wide to the top. So the building is the most wide, where it is the most high. And the third tower is done by Claude Vasconi, who stayed rather close to the sort of theoretical proposition we did. This is the part where the viaduct runs through the station. You can see here that the viaduct is anchored in the station. Therefore, the concrete slab is formed into a metal slab because the viaduct itself is in metal. But all the contortion forces and the braking forces, they are held up by the station, which means that the viaduct itself is only supported by four arches on single points, because the arches just take the vertical forces. And another thing is that we are still discussing with the French railroad architect, in telling him that it's much more interesting if he makes not two parts of the roof, but that the roof is a continuous element, so that the station is read in the project as a horizontal continuity, which has its strength from its horizontally, which corresponds also to the movement of the trains, and that the three towers are on top of it, confirming it in a new skyline as landmarks. And we're working now with this architect and Over Arabs in trying to invent some way of connecting the roof on either side of the bridge. Another important element that had been created before we started to work in Lille is an automated metro line. It's the first city that has a fully automatic operated metro line. So somewhere in the city there is a cellar, and in this cellar there are engineers, and they are following like a sort of little James Bond, following the metros on this scheme and on these monitors. But there's no one on the trains anymore. So you have also, it's the only public transport system that I know of where you are having a view in the driving direction. It's almost a sort of law that if you are in a public transport, you can only have a view perpendicular to your movement, and if you have private transport, like a bicycle or a car, it is in the driving direction, because you're responsible of that. But here, you're not responsible of the driving, but you still have the view and the place of the driver. Okay, this is to resume the thing section. This is a section looking north. So here is a rest of a military barracks. One of the barracks is used by our client as his office. So he took, in a way, the place of the military engineer that started off the whole thing in the 18th century. Here you have the viaduct, eventually going over the station, going over the site where the parkings are, over the motorway, and then into the suburbs, or you know, the periphery, where we will do just one more housing project to really mark a continuity of the contemporary scheme and a very marked bridge between the contemporary scheme and the existing. And this is looking the other way. So I'm starting at this spot, but looking the other way. Buildings along the motorway, the metro station, the station, the tower of Christian Pozampar, the facade of the restaurants of the triangle, of the commercial center, the housing and the hotel, here the entrance, where there is, you can hardly see it, there it will be a very large column here with publicity on it, but which will also help in directing or manipulating in a way the choice of getting either into the building here or following the public walk down towards the station. And this is the existing station. So you can also see the sort of nearness between the existing city here and the periphery there, which is completely connected by these series of elements. And in that pedestrian movement, the main connector has become the metro station, which is this one. So here's the mezzanine of the station, the lake, etc. And the metro station is sort of main connector. This is viewed from above. A series of passerelles, two elevators, and the elevators will eventually carry the roof of the station as well. So the roof will be hovering over the station, which allows free ventilation, which means that all the other infrastructures can be connected to one to the other, which fire regulations otherwise would never allow. So this is in terms of view. You're here on the public space, the lake, the station, the metro station, and if you are on the edge of the lake, so here, then these are your possible view lines, and they're stopped here by structure, of course. And if you are farther away on the terraces of the restaurants, these are your possible view lines. So you see that even if you have this enormous thickness of all these components, one to the other, there is still enough emptiness to see through it. So here you have the different layers. The structure of the station, the facade of the metro, and the back wall of the metro. So if you would project on the back wall of the metro, then from the train station you would still see this, and from the public space you would still see this. So there is an enormous presence visually of each element in this point. Plus the fact that it is it has an interesting condition of sunlighting. And so the thing that we invented is saying, okay, you can do, for instance, a skating rink, and then even leave out completely the roof. So the skating rink itself becomes the roof of the metro station, and you can open up the parkings and everything and see even the city behind. But that appeared to be just one program component too many, so one owner too many in this thing. So we had to abandon this idea. And then we thought we do it like a harmonica, so we take out the skating rink and all the vertical transport that's in there, we lift it, we take it like a harmonica, we draw it until the grade level, which is up here. So then the imagery completely changed and it became a space of movement. And in this space of movement, we can introduce a lighting project which can transform in a way between day and night also the perception of the space. This gives how it works in the pedestrian movement. The lake here, the public plaza, another metro station which is in the public plaza, then a passerelle into the mezzanine of the train station, through the metro station, and then over the covering of the motorway, and then towards the periphery. So the whole thing here, periphery, and all the programs until the existing city are connected, And in this direction, over this passage, both parkings to the north and the south are connected. So you have also a connection between private and public transportation. But this shows the situation in the site. This is already in the train station, so there is a complete continuity in terms of material, because the train station will remain just the rough concrete as it is. So the train and the metro station will be a continuous space expressing the engineering work. So you will see the wall with opening towards the parkings, the columns that are supporting the road above, the beams that are holding up the station if there is a derailment of the trains. And this is viewed from the other side. This is from the platform of the station into this metro space. Can you do the other? It works? I also want to say something about the techniques we're using in this project. You've seen the collage, you've seen the models, hand drawings. These perspectives that you've seen are mixed drawing and computer imagery. But the main tool we are now using, because we are not only the supervising architect but also the designers of the public space, we are also in that sense the ones that have to resolve all the interfaces between the different projects, and therefore we use a computer program which allows us to integrate of each of the individual project architects to use their data on disk and to integrate it into one and to see how it works together in the precise details. So to go back, what's wrong? Can I go back? Yeah, okay. So The next view is to show what this view does from the pedestrian level. It's taken over here. Can it be of any help? Try again? Yeah, it's okay. It's fine with me. It again shows the nearness. These are the army barracks, and this is already the existing city station. Or this is how you can view it by night. If you're driving over the motorway, then you see really through all the elements and see the publicity of the bank in the city, which is by some coincidence also the banker of our client.
Did you
what is it, a carousel boat?
We'll turn the caravan.
No, girls, there's not a problem. What the problem is I think, is that the ground plate is shifted. Did you check that?
The what?
This thing, the ground plate.
No, it's all right.
But it should work. I mean,
the carousel. We'll change it. It's no problem. Just.
I just let you work. Yeah.
We'll
okay.
Try.
So when we were asked to do this project, there was a competition, and the competition was between 8 architects. And I want to tell you this because it shows something of the will of a continuity in the follow up of the project. These 8 architects, they did an interview before a jury. In this jury were intellectuals, architects, writers, philosophers, but also politicians, of course. And except for the politicians, this committee remained after the interviews and the choice of the architect who got the job, and became a commission of peers, which is following up the project all the way, and they are overseeing it some 4 times a year, which is a very interesting situation because their co-house is confronted with, or we are confronted with, say peers who have no real influence, who have no real responsibilities, and which are therefore free and to discuss the project in any way they want. So there really we have a sort of fierce discussion and a very open discussion on the project. Are you almost done? Okay. All right, this is the, I was showing you the view from the periphery towards the city. This is the other way around. Here on in the existing central city, looking towards the entrance of the commercial center, but again in the sort of tricked view of the commercial people, who are showing this as an enormous openness, but we have been fighting with them for 2 years to open the facade, because they thought that they were just doing a periphery box, which is in France, a commercial center in France, is just a box. It's closed. There's one hole in it, it's where you go in and out. And around it is a sort of sea of cars, and that's it. And everything is done inside. But so after all this, they start really now start to discover through their own imagery that it is interesting in opening up this thing. And also considering the facade as an element that's commercially attractive. Okay, this is again towards the periphery. So our commission of the public spaces led to an analysis in connecting the public outside space as much as possible towards the inside of the center, to use the spaces which are these ones under the viaduct, in order to have a public space that is as fluent as possible, but at the same time is animated by a series of facade work programs that are either related to the main commercial center or related to elements that are connected to the viaduct. Okay. So here you see the thing, we did also this sort of sun study, so this is in May about 3 o'clock, where this is the plaza. And the interesting, what I think is interesting is the fact that it's a continuity of space, but the quality is very different. Here you have restaurants in front of a station, and it's a rather serene space, which is also, the serenity is very interesting because you have a concentrated possibility of being here on the terrace, or either walking through here and then having the view of the station. But on the north part, you find a lot more programs. There's one tower, there's this hotel, there is a metro station, there is here a cultural facility for researchers on architecture, an interface with the park. The blue thing is the lawn of the park. It's a bowling green, in a way. And this is the wooded area of the park. And then this building is the exhibition space of this architectural institution. So the north part is in a way much more multi-programming space than the south part of the plaza. And this cultural institution is, I think, interesting because it will be the starting point of a network of European cities where people that are working in these cities in terms of city planning or architecture or management, city management, urban management, can discuss what they're dealing with, but also can explain it in a way that it can be presented to a larger public. And these exhibitions will be prepared in this institution and then travel also through the other cities in a way to not only for researchers and people of the profession, but also for the general public in having a better understanding in what the city is, how it works, and why some cities are more interesting than other ones. In terms of the treatment of the public space, it begins with water, then a sloping plane, a horizontal plane, which is the continuity of the terraces, and it goes on before this architectural cultural institution, then again a sloping plane and a horizontal plane which is connected to the main entrance to the shopping hall, and then the bus station, the existing station, the city, and so forth. So the sloping parts are done in wood all the time, and the horizontal parts are done in natural stone, in small things that we intend to do by Portuguese craftsmen. So they don't get a pattern. They are free in a way by choosing the stone and making another aleatory pattern. And so this project it's started here, and we're now also working on the Congress building, where we start by unifying, because in the existing city, the surfaces they're doing almost every sidewalk different, and here trying to make a treatment that is the marking one big element, or a treatment that is marking here this street, but connecting the street here over the station, where it's the white is where the station building is, here you can cross over and connecting it to the park. So that's the choice of the materials also explains the continuity of certain spaces. So I'll be doing detailed things. In the public space, I've been talking of the minerals, but also, of course, the vegetal part, the park, but also the smaller vegetal elements are of importance, and we are connecting them through the a boardwalk that will be built over the motorway. Sorry, this is the main existing green space, which is this cemetery. And this is the boardwalk over the motorway, which will be the north-south connector of all these green spaces. Well, these are some sections explaining how this cultural institution works. It has two parts. It has one element here, which is exhibition space, where you have here a section which does basically this. So it goes through the viaduct and then the facade on the plaza of the cultural institution. And then to the north, you have this series of ramps. So there are three levels of building, and they're toppled by a series of ramps. So it connects for the pedestrian over the ramps, the passage over the station and the level of the park with the level of the plaza. So the north edge of the public space will be a series of these facades, but also a series of ramps on top of which you see the movement of the pedestrians. So this is where the ramps are, and this is where the main building is. Yeah. This I've shown this not only to explain this cultural institution, but also to explain something about phasing. This is the plaza level of this architectural institution, and this is the park level of it. So there will be pavilions in the park, which mark them from the city, but from the plaza side, it will have two levels. So it will be very urban from the plaza, and it will be pavilions in the park from the city. So it has a double lecture, but it will always be visible and present. That will be the first phase, which is the part of the public at large. And then the research area will be done in the second phase, which can only be done because the whole built site is almost as big as the whole site. So the park is in the beginning necessary for storage of the building site. So only in the second phase we can do the full cultural building, but also do the full park when all this is ready and the concrete mills and so on forests are gone. Another thing we're working on is a project for the lighting of the public space, where this is the restaurants of the shopping mall, the viaduct, and the plaza north and south. We think that the plaza could be lit basically from the restaurants and their publicity and the station, and then it needs only a sort of added on lighting, which can be done by smaller elements, which can be on the plaza. The viaduct, the roads will be lit from their handrails, which means that there will be no large traditional projectors. So the light that is not necessary for the street level will remain on the viaduct, whereas under the viaduct we can have projectors which project the underside of the viaduct so that it becomes itself the screen which is lighting the space. This is a project for the commercial center in doing the tops of these towers. So all the towers are toppled by a 10-meter crown, which is a lighting device, which can be a publicity device, but which is also taking care of all the machines that are on top of these roofs. So this is the roof of the triangle. This is during the daylight. So you see it's a slick plane of metal, gridiron metal. And then at night, where the malls are, the lighting goes up. And this is the underside. So it's not only from the outside that you can perceive the roof as one continuous plane, but also from the inside. So when you are in the center in any of these malls, you can perceive the continuity of the roof as the roof is hovering over all of the shops. So this is an impression of the edge of the building, where it shows that when these buildings are all in use, then they will give already an enormous amount of lighting in the public space. And once the lighting gets lower, then the automatic system can bring in more traditional street lighting. This is the parking of the shopping center. So there is a signaling on the floor, but at the same time there are projectors running where the malls are. So within the parking you can see through the beams of these projectors where how the commercial floor is organized. And these projectors, they will shine on the ceiling, which these are the ceilings of the two parking levels, and the ceilings are clad with aluminum isolation sheets which reflect. So they reflect the projectors that indicate the malls on the, say, on the public world above the parking. And at the same time, it has, you can hardly see it on this thing. Here you can see it. Tubes, lighting tubes, which are about 15 centimeters in diameter, and which become smaller when you come deeper into the parking. So it shows the car driver the way to his parking place, and then again the way out. Another important component of the study is a wind analysis. So there was a model made when we were far enough to do so, and it was brought to a wind tunnel, so where they normally test cars or whatever. You can hardly see it. They're doing their testing with a monitor, which goes over the thing where they can simulate the depths and the distance from the ground floor. And it's done by a little wire, which has a certain temperature. So when there is a lot of turbulence, the temperature goes down, and that's how they measure the thing. And then we got, of course, from that a very scientific, but like bookkeepers, they give us lists and pages for each measuring points of the figures. So I told them that there was no way of dealing with these things. I mean, I can't understand it, I can use it. and I asked them to find a graphical way of expressing it. And the graphical way is in color, whether it's much or not so much. It gives the orientation. This is east, west, and so on for us. And so it gives the orientation in which the wind blows, and the width of this thing gives the strength. So all of a sudden, you have for each point a graphical way that you immediately see where the wind comes from, whether it's strong or whether it's not strong, or whether it's frequent and whether it's not frequent, because you measure it in speed but also in frequency. So then what we did is, having done these measurements and having made a program where we said that each color is so this is low, the lowest wind speed, this is sort of middle wind speeds, and the other parts is where we consider that you're basically walking and nothing else for the sort of higher wind speeds. If you compare then the program to the measurements, you see a set of problems, but then you can introduce all kinds of smaller elements and measure in a way the effect they have on the turbulences. And you can see in this thing that these dots have become much smaller, and so that it is possible by with minor interventions in hindsight to modify the wind conditions. The last thing I will talk about is the project we are doing on the other side of the railroads, which is the Congress Center. So this is the main part, so the second phase, and here the Congress Center. This is the site of the Congress Center, the railroad tracks, and the existing fairgrounds. Thank you. Here you can see the three components. This is the Congress Center, the rock and roll, the rock hall for auditorium for 5,000 people. Here is the Congress Center, which has four main auditoria, and then smaller rooms here, and the banquet hall, and all these kind of programs that go with the Congress Center, and a large exhibition hall, and then here the different entrances, which are carved out in a socle. So there is a rectangular socle, and there is almost an oval-shaped building sitting on top of the socle. And all these entrances allow to use, for instance, the exhibition space as three different halls, but also as one, or even have manifestations that use the whole building. This is the rock auditorium, and this is towards the Congress Center. Here you see the rock auditorium, and it's possible with a sliding wall to connect the rock auditorium with the space under the auditoria of the Congress Center. So the auditoria of the Congress Center are amphis that are sloping down this way and this way, creating a void underneath, which is the basis of opening up the stage. We were heavily depending, of course, on all these kind of computer diagrams for calculating the double curved forms that we're dealing with, not only for the roof, but also for this auditorium. And this is a model that has been done on a 1-4 scale by the contractor. And it's 1/4 of this rock auditorium. And it's made to study the forms of for the concrete, because in a way the forms of in which the casting of the concrete is being done will in the end create a sort of writing on the underface of this hall. So we're very interested and keen on these castings are done in an interesting way. So this is the next one, the auditoria here, and then here the smaller halls, banquet halls here, and the sort of free space which allows the connection between the rock auditorium underneath, and so to open up the stage and having not only the small depths of a stage of a rock auditorium, but also the larger depths if you wanted to do opera or something else. So here are the three components together, the rock hall, the Congress, and the exhibition. We had a lot of fight with the exhibition people because they thought that it would be interesting in having a sort of a daylight condition, but that's something that's not at all comparable So we found one another in a solution where we have translucent walls all around, so that the daylight is not disturbing the fares in the sense that it would be too much light within the space, but at the same time you still have a feeling of the daylight conditions when you are within. And then the roof is pointing curved down, so it means that when you look from the outside to the building, you see it's toppled down. As the roof slopes down in the space, the roof participates as a sort of facade in giving a sense of space, because you can see that there's just a few columns, so there's almost no matter of defining the space otherwise. And the other thing this shows is that we used, there was no way of making a false ceiling, so you would see all the machines that are here. So then we proposed to do the beams, which are composed for the roof, with wood, and the wood works with the steel structurally, so the wood has a structural function, and so we could say smuggle in a false ceiling. Okay, this is the artist impression again from the thing. I would like to stop with this. Thank you. Okay, Burger.
I'd like to thank this was a huge urban project of a small scale. I was told it was about the 7 billion Norwegian Kroner project. That's Olympic Games.
This was the concept. from there on started the more, much more technical work. I showed you the thing we did for the Rochester Tower, where it involved really a tremendous job working with different engineers and finding out what are really the technical and programmatic conditions of the building before giving it out to the next architect. So in publications, and I think it has in part also to do with the sort of interest of members, is that these cartoon-like drawings, they have an enormous appeal, so it's easy to publish. And the other things, they're a little bit boring, but they show much more of the sort of technicality and the know-how that you had to apply in order to control the project. So there is, I showed many different graphic means, some very with enormous precision, and some with another. I think also the cartoons are very precise, in the sense that they are precise in convincing that a certain composition is possible and interesting. And other drawings are used to show that a certain perspective really is existing in the space, so there you need a computer drawing to convince people that it is mathematically correct. So all these means have their own reasoning, and these images you saw, these glossy things, they have also a meaning, because they are people working for the developers who have to sell off their product. So then we see how the developer is appropriating the building he has bought, because he's buying it from drawings. So then by and by he starts really understanding the thing, and through these images starting in a way explaining also how he sees the thing, which allows us in say the re-explaining him of the real potential of the building. It sometimes helped, for instance, in changing the elements of the facade.
Any more questions? Well, we have a tradition to give a guest a gift. And we were this day around to see